In this segment, we're going to consider ray surface intersection, which is really the heart of a ray tracer. Ray surface intersection was one of the main initial research areas, as a result of which there are now optimized routines for a variety of different primitives, triangles, spheres, cubes, etc. Notice that different types of rays may need different types of information. For shadow rays, you just need intersection or no intersection. If you do find an intersection, it doesn't even need to be the closest intersection. For primary rays, you want the point of intersection, the materials at that point, the normal at that point, texture coordinates at that point. In this segment, we'll try to work out examples for a triangle, for a sphere, and talk about polygons and general implicit surfaces. Let's first talk about ray-sphere intersection, which is one of the most canonical cases. First, we need to have a way of defining the ray as well as a way of defining the sphere. The ray is defined like this. You have an origin, P0, and you have a direction, P1. T is a parameter along the ray that starts from 0 and is positive, corresponds to the distance along the ray. A sphere is measured with respect to the central location, C. So P minus C for any point on the sphere, the dot product with itself, which is the length square, has to be equal to R squared, where R is the radius. What we want to find is what is the location of these intersection points. The way we do it, and the way we do all of the ray sphere intersections, all of the ray surface intersections, is to substitute the ray equation into the equation for the sphere. So in this case, P is equal to P0 plus P1T. I will substitute that in the equation for the sphere. So P0 plus P1T minus C, okay? And now I want the dot product with itself to be equal to R squared. So let me just reprise that equation. We substituted the ray formula in the sphere, and we said P0 plus P1T minus C dot product with itself has to be equal to R squared. This is simple, and what we are solving for is the distance along the ray T. So we know the other parameters. We know P0 and P1 for the ray. We know the central location C for the sphere, as well as the radius R squared. Simplifying, we'll see that the T terms will give you T squared here. And so you have T squared. That gets multiplied by P1 dot product with P1. Then we have the T term. So P1 into P0 minus C dot product with P0 minus C, P0 minus C dot product with P1. And so we'll have the T terms, P1, which will take a dot product with P0 minus C. Then we have the constant term, which is P0 minus C dot product with itself minus R squared is equal to 0. So this will be P0 and I've just written it out again on the slide. This is simply a quadratic equation which we have to solve for T. Depending on what the roots of the quadratic equation reveal, we have many different cases that correspond to physically to different ways in which a ray and a sphere can intersect. First, let's consider the case where you have two real positive roots. Of course, this will depend on the value of the discriminant as is standard in quadratic equations. So real sphere intersection routine should first check the discriminant. If you have two positive roots, it means the ray intersects the sphere like this. And in that case, you pick the smaller positive root. If both roots are the same, that means the ray intersects the sphere only once, which means it's tangent to the sphere. If you have one positive and one negative root, that means you're inside the sphere. So the negative part is this intersection, the positive part is here. And in this case, what you want to do is pick the positive root because a ray does not have T less than 0. And if you have complex roots, that means there is no intersection between the ray and the sphere. So before you try to solve this equation, you should check to make sure that the discriminant is positive. Finally, you've solved this equation for the T, which results in an intersection point. Then you need to find what the actual intersection point in physical coordinates is. That's simple. You substitute back into the equation for the ray, p0 plus p1t, where you use the value of t you just solved for. You may also need to know the surface normal at the point of intersection. This is useful for a variety of different tasks, such as shading. In the case of a sphere, you know that the normal lies on the direction from the point to the center of the sphere, and so that's just p minus c normalized. Having discussed spheres, let's come now to another commonly used primitive, which is triangles. And in homework 3, you will have to do spheres and triangles. There are many different ways to intersect a ray with a triangle, and if you search for it online, you'll come up with many different solutions. It's really one of the most fundamental problems because triangles are the most commonly used primitives, so you want to make that fast. In this lecture, we'll consider first a general ray polygon intersection routine, and then we'll talk about a check if this intersection point is actually inside the triangle. First, let's consider a triangle like this. The three vertices of the triangle are A, B, and C. You want to know what the normal to this triangle is, so let me just write it down. So you have the normal, and this will be given by, you can consider any two directions on the triangle. So you have C minus A and B minus A. It can be given by C minus A cross product with B minus A. I've just normalized the cross product here. The next question is, what is the equation for a plane? You may remember this from high school geometry. Essentially, the normal dot product with any vector in the plane has to be zero. So if you consider any point P in the plane, which is any point P in the triangle, here is the P, then if you consider the vector P minus A, it lies along the plane, the normal with that is zero. So n dot p minus a is 0, which is the same as saying that p dot n minus a dot n is equal to 0. Next, you want to combine this with the ray equation. So the ray is again given by p0 plus p1t. We've just substituted that in the plane equation. So p0 plus p1t dot n is equal to a dot n. Now you notice that this is a linear form. So t is multiplied by p1 dot n. And on the other side, you have a dot n minus p0 dot n. And if you put this all together, you'll get solve for t as a dot n minus p0 dot n divided by p1 dot n. Notice that if p1 dot n is equal to 0, this is not defined. And that occurs when the ray p1 direction is orthogonal to the normal direction. So that means the ray lies in the direction of the plane, and in that case, of course, it doesn't intersect it. However, in the common case and in the most general case, you will find a ray plane intersection. That's only half the problem. You still need to find if the intersection point is inside the triangle. There are many possibilities for doing this, and you can do this for triangles and general polygons. Let me briefly say what you would do for a general polygon. One approach to this is to consider your general polygon something like this. It does not need to be convex. And you have a point here. You don't know whether it's inside or outside. So I draw a line from this point to infinity along any direction. Doesn't matter. It could be here. Could be here. If it intersects an even number of times, the point is outside the polygon. If it intersects an odd number of times, notice that in this case it has three intersections, in this case it has one, then it is inside. So odd is in and even is out. However, for the case of triangles, we actually find the intersection parametrically using what are known as barycentric coordinates with respect to the triangle vertices. This is useful in a number of other applications such as texture. If I show the triangle here, A, B, and C are the vertices of the triangle. Alpha, beta, and gamma correspond to the distances of the point P from A, B, and C, respectively. They are normalized so that alpha plus beta plus gamma is equal to 1. This is known as the barycentric coordinates for a triangle. A point P will be given by alpha A plus beta B plus gamma C, where they sum to 1. And furthermore, it's a convex combination, which means that alpha, beta, and gamma are all positive. So now the question is, how do we solve for this? It's simply a system of simultaneous equations. So I can subtract A from P, and I can get beta into B minus A plus gamma into C minus A. What I've done in order to do this is as follows. I went here and I subtracted A, but remember that alpha plus beta plus gamma is equal to 1. So this is equal to A into alpha plus beta plus gamma. The alpha A term then cancels against the alpha A term here, and remember, become beta into B minus A, gamma into C minus A. I can now try to solve this under the condition that 0 is less than beta is less than 1, same for gamma, and they sum to less than 1, so alpha plus beta plus gamma is equal to 1. And I will do this with my intersection point. I have enough equations. I have actually 3 equations for the 3 coordinates of P, but since we are talking about a planar region, one of those becomes degenerate. I have enough equations to determine beta and gamma from the 2 simultaneous equations. So far, we've spoken about spheres and triangles. Much of the early work in ray tracing dealt with other primitives. So it focused on a variety of ray primitive intersection tests for things like cones, cylinders, and ellipsoids. Ray box intersection tests were especially studied and optimized, and this is useful for bounding boxes, and general planar polygons were considered. Many, many other surfaces were considered. You can pick up a ray tracing book and you'll find many ray surface intersection routines. To make it simple, in homework 3, we've just asked for spheres and triangles, but in practice, there are intersection routines with many different primitives. One final aspect of ray tracing and ray surface intersections is intersecting with a transformed object. So consider a common situation where you have an optimized nice ray sphere intersection test in homework 3, but you want to trace the ray to intersect with an ellipsoid because I took my sphere and I scaled it and squashed it and stretched it so it's now an ellipsoid. Very well, I could go look up the ray ellipsoid intersection routines or the general ray quadric surface intersection routines. However, this is not appropriate in the sense that it requires a lot of code. It may not be as efficient as the ray sphere intersection. Fortunately, there's a way around this. Instead of intersecting the ray with the transformed sphere or ellipsoid, I apply the inverse transform to the ray, then intersect it with the original shape and transform it back. This allows for many different things. So one of the things it allows for is instancing. I can take my sphere, create different egg-shaped ellipsoids, and intersect the ray with all of them. I can also create new types of shapes in homework 3, although the intersection points are rays and are spheres and triangles, I can have ellipses and in this way more interesting shapes. So let's talk about the mathematics for ray transform surface intersection. So let's first consider the ray, okay? And I'm going to call it R. And then I'm going to consider the object, which I'm going to call P. And let's call a transform, which is M, is my matrix. So P will go to MP, and I want to intersect the ray and MP. Instead, what I say is that I create a new ray, which is R prime, which is equal to the inverse transform applied to the original ray. Remember that the ray considers an origin and a direction. The origin is in homogeneous coordinates a 4 vector, it's a point. The direction is a vector, and so the homogeneous coordinate is 0. So if I'm translating an object, I apply the inverse translation to the ray, which inverse translates the origin, but has no effect on the direction. Once I have this, I am really computing the intersection between R prime and the original object P. After I've done this and computed this intersection point, let's call it P star. So let's call it P prime star, actually. I then apply the matrix M on this point. So I apply the matrix M on the intersection point. And that gives me my intersection point in the actual world. So let's go over this, and in our homework 3, you should support general transform stacks, just as you do in homework 2. You consider a general 4x4 transform. You apply the inverse transform to the ray, so the locations are stored and transformed in homogeneous coordinates. The vectors, the ray directions, have homogeneous coordinates set to 0, so there's no action because of translations. You do the standard ray surface intersection as modified, and then you transform the intersection back to the actual coordinates, so you apply the transformation matrix M. The normals transform as M inverse transpose times N, that's very important. And finally, you do the lighting, you recompute the distances. It's not very different. Supposing you wanted to do a transformation like rotation, not about the origin, but about some point in space, you first inverse transform the translation to bring it to the center, do the rotation, and then forward transform back. This is the same idea. You first apply the inverse transform to the ray, you do the intersections, and then you apply the forward transform to the intersection.